Jurassic Park, Caddyshack, Grease. These films, at least in the opinion of some, have some of the worst sequels ever made. We all know the story, right? Hollywood creates this film, billions of people go to see it, and Hollywood wants to keep following that wide, ever-increasing line of profit, and so they quickly often make a sequel to encourage people to go see the rest of the story. But, thankfully, we all know the secret. The secret that the sequel Hollywood often produces is rarely ever as good and hardly ever better than the original film. This morning we're going to talk about the sequel, the second half of John chapter 4. Last week we came together and talked about the first half of John chapter 4, the story of the woman at the well, where we talked about their shared physical thirst brought them to the well and allowed them to enter into this conversation that revealed Jesus' true identity as the Messiah, God with us. And this woman became aware, perhaps for the first time in her life, that she had this deep spiritual need within her, much greater than any physical water could satisfy. That Jesus would provide the living water, the very Spirit of God, to satisfy her. And this was a beautiful and, it seemed, rather complete story that we talked about last week, a story that caused us to ask the question, where are the wells, the spaces and places that we go in our life, each and every day, expecting to encounter Jesus? And it was our hope that this space could be a well for all of us to come Sunday after Sunday to encounter Jesus. But my friends, what we talked about last week is not the end of the story. This woman's story continues and doesn't just end there at verse 26 where Jesus reveals his identity as the Messiah to the woman. But the story continues. And the good news for us this morning is that unlike Hollywood, this sequel, this second half of the story we're going to talk about, is just as powerful as the first half of the story. This woman's story continues in John 4, beginning this morning with verse 27. Just then, Jesus' disciples came. They were astonished that Jesus was speaking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and were on their way to him. Jumping down to verse 39. Many Samaritans from that city believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I have ever done." So the Samaritans came to him and they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because what you have said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." The disciples come back from the city where they were buying food and burst into the scene, and they're shocked to see Jesus sitting next to this Samaritan woman. And we talked about this last week too, right? Their shock is justifiable for two reasons. One is that Jewish men did not talk to women in public. And the second is that by this time in history, the Jews and Samaritans had been engaged in a 700-year-long family feud that got to the point where they didn't even talk to each other. So Jesus, sitting at the well, talking to a woman of Samaria, is a shock to the disciples. But the woman doesn't have time to deal with the disciples' shock. And she leaves her water jar there with Jesus and runs back to her town to tell people about her encounter at the well. "Come and see the man who told me everything I have ever done." You see, that woman's experience with Jesus was so compelling that she had to go and tell others about him. She could simply stay there at the well or return back to her normal life, but she had to go tell others about this experience she had with Jesus at the well. "Come and see." That is this woman's invitation to her neighbors. And my friends, that is where we find ourselves this morning. You see, last week, like the woman at the well, we too came to the well and encountered Jesus in worship together. And I don't know about you, but last Sunday to me was such a beautiful moment where we sat together in Jesus' presence and really encountered him and when we're aware of our deep spiritual thirst for him. It was a beautiful moment of coming to the well and sensing the true abundance of God's Spirit Jesus has to offer us. And perhaps some of us may have even wanted to push pause and freeze that moment, just to stay in it forever. But my friends, as beautiful as that moment is, and as often as we have to keep coming to the well, day after day, to receive the abundance of God's Spirit, we can't push pause and stay there forever. We have to continue on to live into the sequel, to live into the rest of the story of the verses that we just read after and the continuation of the woman's story in John 4. You see, because we don't just come to the well, we must also go and tell. Coming to the well and going and telling are not mutually exclusive. They're not opposites. In fact, instead, they are deeply connected and deeply related. You see, because we come to the well in order to be filled with the abundance of God's Spirit, to bask in Jesus' presence, to allow our conversation with Jesus to go deeper and deeper, we come to the well to be filled with the abundance of living water so that we can then go and tell. And that allow the abundance of that Spirit living within us to flow out and impact those around us, that we could be a source of life to those around us, that the living water in us bubbles up and spreads to all those that we come and contemplate. Come and see is the invitation that we too offer to our friends and our family members and to our neighbors, to come and see Jesus, to come with us to the well. This week at St. John's was my first hospitality meeting. And it was an incredible meeting, learning about all the different activities this church does throughout the year to offer hospitality to those people in our community. And it was an incredible meeting for so many reasons. But I think for me, the best part of that meeting that made it so memorable to me was that time and time again, I heard from different voices around the table, people expressing this desire to invite people to St. John's. I heard stories where you used to have pack the pew Sundays for rally days, and you would challenge each other to invite as many people as you could to fill a whole pew, and over 300 people would be at this church on Sunday. Or I had stories and a desire about inviting your friends and family members and neighbors to the chicken barbecue coming up in September or to the bonfire in October. And I heard this desire to reach out and invite new people moving into our neighborhood to come to church. And my friends, I was so blessed by these stories and the desires lifted up around the table. And to be quite honest with you, sitting at that meeting that Monday confirmed for me what I would preach and say to you this morning. You see, because last Sunday I actually had a different plan of what passage I was going to preach from this morning. But then I felt God leading me in a different direction, and I thought it was a little crazy that it would be strange to continue on with John chapter 4 and talking about going and inviting our neighbors to church. That seemed odd to me. And so I asked Chris, I'm like, Chris, is this strange idea? Is it too soon to say something like this? And he's like, no, it's not too soon. It's not your craziest idea. And so I still, though, was a little uncertain. And then sitting in that meeting, it was like God confirming to me, Hannah, yes, I'm laying John 4, the second half, the sequel, on your heart to share with St. John's this morning. Because at least some of them are ready to go. Come to the well and go and tell. You see, the beautiful part of this sequel that we've been talking about this morning is this woman at the well has one encounter with Jesus, an encounter that's so powerful and life-changing that she has to go tell others about it. She has to share her story of coming to the well and encountering Jesus. And what's absolutely amazing to me is this woman who has this troubled past. Remember, we talked about her 500 husband scenario last week. She has this troubled past and probably troubled reputation, but she still goes around telling all who will listen about her encounter with Jesus at the well, sharing her story and inviting them to come and see Jesus. Come and see the man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he? You see, this is shocking to me because this woman is not even 100% sure that Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus told her that he is the Messiah, but she's not even 100% sure if she believes that yet. But her doubt and uncertainty does not stop her from sharing this incredible encounter that she has at the well. And what's crazy to me is that this woman with this troubled past and interesting reputation, with even some doubt and fear and anxiety, goes out and shares her story. And the crazy part is, people listened. People listened to her story. And people received her invitation and began flocking to Jesus. In fact, they came to Jesus and began to have their own encounter with him and were so astonished by the person of Jesus that they begged him to stay with them. And Jesus stayed there 2 days. And many more people came to Jesus through that time. And they began to realize, yes, it was the woman's story that first brought them there. Then they received her invitation to come. That story was how they came to encounter Jesus. But now that they had spent time with Jesus, they were beginning to develop their own stories. And they had their own experience with Jesus at the well. And no longer was it just because of the woman's story, but it's because of their own story that they came to believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world. My friends, this one woman with a troubled past and an interesting reputation shares her story, and many others come to the well and come to believe in Jesus. Imagine and see the ripple effect of her one story and her invitation. And I think that can be true and is true for us because each one of us here have our own stories. You have stories long before I even set foot in this church where you have come and encountered Jesus. Where you have sat at the well and been filled with the living water, with the abundance of his Spirit. You have stories in your personal lives where you may have sat at the wells in your lives, at breakfast tables or empty chairs or in nature like we talked about last week. You have stories of God's abundance in your life. You have stories that you can share with your friends, family members, and neighbors, and invite them to come and see Jesus. My friends, you all have these stories to tell. And if nothing else, you have stories about our time together, of last Sunday of coming to the well, and of this Sunday about going and telling. We all have stories that we can share as we go forth from this place, inviting others to come and join us. But we also might have doubts. We, like the woman at the well, might not even be 100% sure if we believe that Jesus truly is the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And that's okay. You don't have to have it all figured out. You don't have to have the perfect theology. You don't even have to be 100% certain that you believe each and every day. The woman did it, but that didn't stop her from sharing her story. You might be thinking, you know, I'm not qualified to share my story. I don't have that many good stories. I'm afraid. What if people don't listen to me? What if they don't take me seriously? What if they just brush me off and think I'm crazy? It's okay. These fears and anxieties are completely justifiable. But none of these fears and anxieties should stop us from sharing our stories. They didn't stop that woman at the well. They shouldn't stop us. Because if we just trust Jesus enough to share our story and then just trust Jesus to do the rest, that's all the woman at the well did, right? She shared her story, and then it was up to those people to come to see if they would respond to the invitation. And they did, and they encountered Jesus, and then that was enough for them. And then they too could share their story with others. We are just to be the inviters. It's Jesus who's the person that will lead them. You know, I think to visualize this, it's like we here at St. John's are one big dam. I know that might sound a little strange, but go with me for a little bit. Each one of us is a little dam with our own levels of water, living within inside of us. And together we are all one big dam with a level together of living water, the abundance of God's Spirit, living in each one of us. And so, like a dam, we have a certain fill level, a fill line. And then over time, as we continue to come to the well and encounter Jesus, more and more living water, more of the abundance of God's Spirit begins to fill up within each one of us and within our lives together. As we come to worship here on a Sunday morning through a prayer or a sermon or a song or in silence, we are filled with more of the abundance of God's Spirit. Or in our daily lives when we do devotion or read scripture or pray or walk in the woods, we are filled with the abundance of God's Spirit. And then as that abundance of God's Spirit continues to bubble up in us, we can't contain it. And eventually, it reaches to the point where we have to get ready and open the floodgates and allow the living water that's within us to burst forth. Friends, the time is coming and is perhaps already here where it is time for us to open the floodgates and to allow the living water built up within us to flow out to reach all those around us. Because we come to the well not for ourselves, but for the sake of the world so that we can share it with others. Now, I do have one word of caution. Like a dam, sometimes when the water is released, it provides life to all those around it to raise the water levels in the water table. And that's fantastic because often when we share our stories and when we talk about Jesus, that brings life to all those around us. But sometimes when dams release their water, it's destructive and causes a flood and brings damages to the things around it. And there can sometimes be ways that we talk about Jesus that are damaging or bring destruction. So I want to make it clear, I'm not asking you to go share your stories of God's abundance or how you're encountering Jesus. I'm not asking you to go yell those up and down the streets in Chambersburg. I'm not asking you to do that. I'm not asking you to feel like you have to have all the right answers. I'm not asking you to feel like you have to talk super loud and feel like you're being heard. I'm not asking you to feel like you have to shove your story down someone's throat. Instead, all I'm asking you to do is to pick one person this week, to invite them to come and see Jesus. Just think of one person that you already have a relationship with, a friend, a family member, a neighbor, maybe even someone you know who used to come to this church but for whatever reason stopped attending a while ago. Think of one person, and I want you to write the name of that person down on your bulletin. Maybe several come to mind, write several names down, that's great. And I want you to picture what it would look like to invite that person to come to church with you this week. Maybe it's as simple as picking up the phone and having a conversation, catching up with them, seeing how they're doing, and saying, you know, we have this crazy new pastor, and she plays with water in the service, and I thought you might actually want to come check it out. It would be great to see you. We really miss you here. Or maybe you want to meet up and have lunch or dinner or coffee with them and talk with them about where you're seeing God in your life, the stories of God's abundance that you are seeing in your life, your encounters with Jesus at the well. Maybe you want to share that with them and invite them to come with you next Sunday to encounter Jesus at the well. My friends, this week, invite just one person to come back with you to the well next Sunday. The worst they can say is no, and you'll never know unless you ask. We, like the Samaritan woman, can just offer the invitation, come and see, and then we pray and trust that Jesus does the rest. Statistics tell us that 79% of people who attend church first started attending because a friend or a family member invited them. So be that friend or family member this week and invite one other person to join you in this place next Sunday. My friends, let us keep